But I consider your heavens and the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have ordained. What is man that you take thought of him, and the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than God, and you crown him with glory and majesty. You make him to rule over the works of your hands. You have put all things under his feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the heavens, the fish of the sea. Whatever passes through the paths of the sea, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. It is to you, O God, that we come and bow before you. Lord, calm our hearts, our minds. Arrest our attention that we might hear your voice. Lord, we acknowledge that you are holy and righteous, and there is none like you in all the earth.
Yes.
Lord, we bless you because you are our great God. You are Adonai. You are El Elyon. You are the Most High God. God, we ask that you would forgive us for our sins as we stand in your presence. We know, O God, that no unclean thing can stand in your presence. Your word reminds us that we confess our sins. You are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Lord, we ask that you would clean us up. Take the scales off of our eyes, that we might see you high and lifted up, that we might experience your presence, that we might bask in your glory. Lord, we acknowledge our need for you. We acknowledge that you are holy. We acknowledge that you are all sufficient. Lord, we thank you because you're gracious and you're merciful. We thank you because you are just and righteous. We thank you because you are a wonderful counselor. A mighty God, an everlasting Father. You are the Prince of Peace. And even this government is on your shoulders. We thank you, O God, that you are still in control. You are the all-sufficient one. You are Elohim. You are all-powerful. You are El Olam. You are the everlasting God. You are Jehovah Jireh. You have been our provider. You are Jehovah Rapha. You are healer. Bless your name. How majestic is your name in all the earth. Speak to our hearts, O God. Your servants desire to hear your voice. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you are my strength and my redeemer. word, Lord, we need to hear from you this day. Speak. Your servants desire to hear your voice. Lord, we give you our attention. Have your way in this place. Powerful name of Jesus Christ, we pray and ask all of these things. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning. Sister Rhonda, did you say our guest is from Kenya? Wanda Asa Fwewe. I don't know what you said, but I know it's not true. She said, amen. Amen. God is good. Amen. While I'm thinking about it, Sister Baldwin, I want to acknowledge your mom and dad. I want you all to stand up also.
Representing the royal family.
says in verse 11, Beloved, I urge you as aliens and strangers. Now remember, this is not the first time we see these words used in verse 1 of 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as aliens. An alien is one who is not a resident of the place in where he is, in which he currently resides. He is a foreigner. He is a stranger. He is a passerby. He is a sojourner. He says, I urge you as aliens and strangers to abstain. That's to have something because of being far away or separating from something else. To abstain is to be so far away from this that you automatically are this. To abstain from fleshly lust. You are kingdom residents. You are a holy priesthood. You're people who are separated for God's holy purpose, and because of that, you must live as an alien. You must abstain from fleshly lusts. Now, it's important for us to understand that just because we have been called out of darkness into His marvelous light, that we still have to deal with this flesh. Now, I say that because there's a theology out there that says once you are saved, you no longer have to deal with the sinful nature. That is totally error. You, as long as you live on this earth, you're going to have to deal with this flesh. And here's the good news. You can and you are more than a conqueror. Listen, you do not have to yield to your flesh. If you don't hear anything all this morning, you need to understand that you can say no to your fleshly lusts. In fact, not only can you say no, God requires that you say no to your fleshly lusts. A few days ago, Sundays ago, we learned that there is a war for our minds. The enemy wants you to focus on things other than the things of God. There's a war on your mind. The things that you think about is important. The enemy wants you to focus on your flesh. Listen, by the way, if you wake up, if your way of dealing with the flesh is waking up and focusing on not appealing to the flesh, chances are you are going to appeal to your flesh. Paul says in Galatians, if you walk in the Spirit, then you will not fulfill the desires of the flesh. God not only requires that we abstain from fleshly lust, He gives us the means to do so. Thank God for the Spirit. Amen? He gives us the Holy Spirit, which is the means, a supernatural ability that He gives us to say no to the lust of the flesh. Listen, you can no longer say, as a believer in Jesus Christ, that I couldn't help myself. Oh, you can help yourself. God has given back. This is the mystery, the Bible says, that has been hidden all throughout the ages, which is Christ in you. You have Jesus Christ living in you on the inside. You have this treasure in this broken vessel. And He reminds us that we might proclaim the excellencies of Christ. It is not about about what the Father desires. scriptures and aliens to abstain from fleshly lust. My first point this morning, be disciplined in subduing your flesh. Listen, if you're going to be victorious in dealing with this flesh, now he's given us his spirit, so we got the flesh that we were born with, and then he's given us his spirit that should overrule the flesh. But we always remember the verse that says the spirit is willing, but the flesh is what? Yeah, the flesh is weak. That's why you can't depend on it. That's why you need to allow the Spirit of God to work in you and through you, which it empowers you to do what you could not do before. Be disciplined in subduing your flesh. The word discipline is training to ensure proper behavior. That means practice. You've got to train yourself in godliness. Listen, if you have an addiction, you've got to avoid those areas that are strongholds in your life. I've shared this many times before. Yes, your pastor had an addiction. I had an addiction with lust. And I fed my lust. And Deacon was saying, I want to be free from this, but I always surrounded myself with the stuff that fed my lust. Now, I know none of y'all have things to deal with, but I'm going to just talk about me. I said, listen, I'm reading the scriptures, I'm looking at the Holy Spirit and how he used common ordinary people. I'm reading about the victory that's in Jesus Christ. I'm even singing the song that victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He bought me and sought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew it. And I forgot the rest of the words. And all my love, he sought me, taught me, and I repented of my sin. Listen, I sang this song, I sang it proud, and meant it, and went home every day and struggled. I didn't have the victory. And I said, you know what, Lord, this victory, this life that you're talking about, it has to be a reality, otherwise your word is not true. And you know what I realized? In order for me to deal with this flesh, a drastic time required drastic means. See, the problem, my problem was, is I wanted to walk on both sides of the fence. I wanted to have my cake and eat it too. Did I say that right? I wanted to watch BET, but I also wanted to live holy. I wanted to watch the video, but I also wanted a clean mind. Some of y'all dealing with different addictions. It might be alcohol. You wanna be clean from alcohol addiction, but you are a social drinker. You're not getting drunk. After all, Pastor Donaldson said that there is no prohibition against drinking, so I'm gonna just socially drink. Drastic times require drastic means. I was tired of living a less than victory. I was tired of living beneath the level of mediocrity. I was tired of coming to church and singing about victory and not having victory in my own life. Any of y'all know about that? You get to the point where you're sick and tired of being sick and tired, where you're tired of praying, Lord, forgive me for this, and you know in your mind that you're going to go ahead and do it again. Then I started reading John, 1 John, and says things like this: if you continue in sin, you have neither seen him nor known him. Well, I know you, Lord, then help me to be victorious. Here's where the drastic means come in. Stop watching TV, period. This is back pre-cell phone. At least back at that time, they had the blocks, the cell phone blocks, weigh about 3 pounds. Stop watching TV. My wife was like, "What's wrong with you? Stop listening to secular radio." Now, I'm not saying that you need to stop listening to secular radio. All that I'm saying, if you really want to deal with your flesh, if you want to be victorious in your flesh, you have got to abstain from fleshly lust. You've got to abstain from those things that are feeding your lust. And that means that, first of all, you've got to be honest with yourself. You got to be honest with yourself. Listen, I knew, and I was singing in the choir and doing everything else and teaching, and I loved the Lord, but listen, my flesh was beating me up because I was feeding it every day. So I stopped doing those things that fed my flesh, and guess what happened? I started getting a victory. I see somebody and I say, "Don't look." And I wouldn't look. And I'd go down the road and almost high-five myself and say, "I won that one." But you understand that, listen, just because you won that little victory does not mean that you are free. How many know that freedom ain't free? Listen, you got to fight.
Amen.
My devotionals on my phone. Thomas Watson said it like this: what fools are they who for a drop of pleasure drink a sea of wrath? Like how Paul says it in 1 Corinthians chapter 9. You need to understand that you've got to exercise restraint, especially in ministry. If you're going to be a servant of Jesus Christ behind enemy lines until Christ comes back, you are behind enemy lines. You are a foreigner. You are a stranger. You're an alien. This is not your home. But until Christ comes back, you need to represent the kingdom. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 24 through 27 says it this way: do you not know that all those who run a race all run, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win. As a believer in Jesus Christ, you have been given a race to run. Don't run to just place. Run to win. What kind of athlete just wants to just finish the race? I know some of those. I mean, you're training, you're going to practice, you're sweating and bleeding and you're lifting weights and you're doing all these things for what? Just finish the race. He says, run in such a way that you may win. And everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. You know the fruit of the Spirit is self-control. The fruit of the Spirit, it says, is love and joy and patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and what? Self-control. That means you need to be under control. That's why it is the antithetical. It's the opposite of saying, do not be drunk with wine, which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Be under the influence of the Spirit of God as opposed to wine. And everyone who competes in the game exercises self-control in all things. They then do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable. Therefore, I run in such a way as not without aim. I box, he changes the analogy, I box in such a way as not beating the air. That is here it is. Brother Jermaine, I know you. We went down to a gym. One of our kids, I won't say who it was. It was boxing, and you know, he was going to training and boxing and stuff, and we saw this guy down there, man. He was about to get in the ring, and you were kind of sizing him up, man. And this dude is about to, man, he about to kill this dude over here. And we thought that because, man, he was hitting the bag, boy, he just looked so smooth hitting that bag, and he was, you know, he's bobbling and he's even punching the bag and moving back. It's like, man, this dude is the truth. He got in the ring. And this dude got beat up so bad. In fact, he quit. He was like, ow! trying to destroy your ministry. The enemy's not playing. It's no joke. So you've got, listen, you've got to exercise restraint. He says, Paul says, I run in such a way as not without aim. I box in such a way as not beating the air. But I buffet my body. That is, I do some things to strengthen myself so that I will be able to finish the race and so that I will be able to win the round. I buffet my body and make it my slave. Don't miss that. And here's why. Lest possibly, after I have preached to others, I should be disqualified. I was watching NCAA finals in indoor track. I forget the young lady's name from Oregon. Fast as lightning. Got two of them actually. Fast as lightning. These girls can run. Gun goes off. I mean, she just left the pack. About 30 minutes later, they found out she stepped out of her lane. In fact, she broke the record. Y'all feel now what it feels like to run and be disqualified because you didn't have self-control. That's how you feel, right? When you have the mindset to do what God has called you to do, and you try to take a shortcut. Listen, there are no shortcuts to God's best. You need to understand that the enemy is always going to be trying to give you a shortcut. Shortcut to sexual fulfillment. Shortcut to success. All these three easy steps to this. Five easy steps to this. Listen, if you're going to walk with Christ and for Christ, then listen, you got to walk up the rough side of the mountain sometime. So, Lord, don't move my mountain. I'm saying, no, Lord, move my mountain. And give me the strength. If it's your will, and give me the strength to climb. As I buffet my body and make it my slave, lest possibly after I have preached to others, I myself should be disqualified. As believers, we must exercise restraint so as to not be disqualified. Secondly, we must acknowledge that we are in a war. Look at